Thank you very much, Audrey, and to everybody who's tuning in this morning, we're all getting used to this very strange way of communicating without being in the same room, and I'm speaking to, I know, an audience of close to 200 people this morning without seeing any of you eye to eye. And in normal circumstances, of course, we would have a room full of people, full of energy, full of questions, full of, I'm sure, opinions and frustrations for a basis of discussion on the topics that we're going to try and deal with today. But instead, because of the times we're living in through this extraordinary pandemic, we're doing this virtually. So I first of all want to thank everybody for tuning in this morning, for being part of this structure in terms of what we're trying to do in under this new concept that we're trying to gain traction for around a shared island initiative, which is about, I hope, building relationships north-south, east-west, and indeed between communities on our island in particular. We have, as I say, close to 200 people tuning in, over 100 organizations representing very different opinions, communities that have very different perspectives on history and in terms of what their dreams are for the future. And the whole point of what the Irish government is trying to do with its Shared Island Initiative is to try to ensure that we have discussion and interaction rather than people keeping to themselves and keeping their opinions to themselves. We want those opinions out in the open in a way that is respectful but also honest. And that again, I hope, will be the tone of the discussion that we have this morning. There's already been two Shared Island dialogues, and they've been very successful. One focused on young people and the role of young people on the island of Ireland in terms of its future and finding ways to respect and understand each other's perspectives and to try to reconcile those. We've also had one on climate and environment in terms of shared ambition and a shared discussion around how the island of Ireland as a whole, north and south, can take an ambitious and world-leading approach in the area of climate, biodiversity and environment. And today we want to focus on the role of civil society. And we know through history the role that many of the organizations represented today have played has been absolutely vital in terms of bringing people together, sharing perspectives and sharing understanding, and forcing conversations that otherwise might not be taking place. We know that civil society groups in many ways have found solutions where politics has failed at times. We know, for example, south of the border, the role in recent years that civil society has played on debates around marriage equality, for example, on the really difficult and divisive debate around abortion and all of the issues relating to that. We know that north of the border, civil society groups have played an extraordinary and constructive role on very emotive issues around flags and parades, for example. And if the truth be told, we are living through another period of history where circumstance is driving polarization and difference and to a certain extent tribalism in relation to the views that are being taken and reinforced because, as I say, of unfolding circumstances linked in particular to Brexit and the protocol issues that people will be so familiar with, particularly in Northern Ireland. Issues that we need to try to resolve together, but also influence others outside of this island, whether in the British government or indeed in the European Commission and the European Parliament, to find pragmatic and sensible solutions that take account of legitimate concerns that people have. So this morning, I think, is an opportunity, I hope, for us to focus on the role that civil society can play, whether that's youth groups, whether it's women's groups, whether it's churches, and religion, whether it's the trade union movement, whether it's environmental NGOs, whether it's groups that are specifically set up to focus on reconciliation and healing. All of you as groups are part of this broad picture of biodiversity and diversity on the island of Ireland that in many ways can, if we find a way to create the structure, can be a very, very rich opportunity in terms of showing the rest of the world how the island of Ireland can be a place of tolerance, of generosity, of difference, but a place that celebrates and manages that difference in a really respectful way. And in my view, we simply cannot do that as politicians on our own. And that has been unfortunately shown over and over again. We need you. We need groups that are actually put in place and exist in order to create those bridges, those new channels of communication, that generosity to actually reach out and try and understand a different person or a different community's perspective on history or indeed on the future. So that is essentially what the Shared Island Unit is about. And it's backed up with a lot of money and it's backed up by a very professional structure in the Department of the Taoiseach, which is the most powerful office in the Irish government. So from an Irish government's perspective, we're very serious about trying to find a way to make this new initiative work. We think it started well. We think the fact that many of you have taken the time to be with us this morning is a reinforcement of that. We have set aside €500 million to spend on projects that are about shared island perspectives, where communities north and south can work together for the mutual interest of everybody. And so this isn't just an academic discussion or a political discussion. It's also about facilitating real structural change and the funding behind that to reinforce what we're trying to do in terms of engagement and understanding. And that's why, from our perspective, the most important element of the Shared Island ambition is engagement and ensuring that all perspectives are heard, regardless of whether you're a majority, a minority, or even a very small minority. We want to make sure that the whole point of this exercise is that everybody's perspective is heard, and it's the strength of people's arguments that actually influence outcomes, as opposed to the strength of numbers or political influence or whatever. So, you know, from my perspective, we really want to work with all of you, all of your groups, in terms of finding a way forward in many of the difficult political challenges that the Irish government faces, that the executive faces, the Assembly faces, the British government faces, and indeed the European Union, who are very much involved in some of these conversations, face as well. And like with so many problems in the past that have been overcome, the role and the intervention of civil society groups and the perspectives that they bring and the example that they give can be a really valuable force for change and for tolerance and for the kind of approach that I believe can lead to a much more settled and content island in terms of a relationship between peoples and perspectives. So that's where we're coming from. And to all of you, as I say, thank you for participating. I hope you'll continue to participate in the dialogues that are still to come. We're going to have one on economic development on the island of Ireland and indeed on these islands, east-west, which of course is complicated by Brexit, but that's why we need to have the conversation. You know, we can't avoid complexity and the difficult conversations. We're going to have one on education too, which personally I believe can really be perhaps the most impactful force for change in terms of reconciliation, generosity and tolerance on the island of Ireland from an education perspective. And we're going to have one on healthcare. And I think the lessons that we are all learning day after day, week after week, in the middle of a pandemic that has been extraordinarily tragic for so many families, but has put our health systems under so much pressure, north and south. There are many, many lessons that we need to share and discuss with each other. And that will be a future focus for a dialogue like we're having this morning on the role of civil society. So look, I look forward to your questions, and let's have an honest and straight discussion that's respectful, but at the same time doesn't avoid for the purposes simply of being polite, doesn't avoid the awkward issues and questions that I think we have an obligation to try to focus on in respectful dialogue so that we can move things forward. So thanks very much, and I look forward to your questions.
We're going to start with a question from Connor Houston from the group Connected Citizens. Connor.
Minister, thank you very much for your remarks and good morning to everybody. It's lovely to see so many friends on the screen this morning. I'm sorry we're not together. Minister, I've been involved with a group and I see a number of them this call. I know Jimmy Nesbitt's coming in shortly. We found a group called Connected Citizens and we're about having informed and inclusive conversations about all of our options for the future. And as part of our work, we are bringing One Young World, the largest global youth summit in the world, to Belfast in May 2023. So for my generation, the Shared Island Initiative must be about realising the ambition of our home and our people through the possibility of relationships. We believe there are three things that we need to do to better understand each other. One, we need to listen. We need more places and spaces for inclusive and diverse conversations. Two, inform. We need to have informed, evidence-based conversations about the kind of society we want to be based on shared values, not ideologies that have kept us apart. And three, to act. We need to empower communities to be active citizens and get behind our grassroots activists who are already driving change every day. So my question, Minister, is when thousands of young people from every country in the world come to Belfast for One Young World in May 2023, what would you tell them that we have actively done to realise the ambition of my generation and this generation across this island to build the kind of society we want for our children? Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Connor. And big question there. Can I say, though, that and I'm just going to digress just for 1 second, because I think it's important to put a context around this question. As a Minister for Foreign Affairs, under normal circumstances, I travel a lot. And even in the pandemic, I travel. And a lot of people, I think, living on the island of Ireland, north and south, perhaps underestimate just how influential the Irish peace process and its success. Nothing is perfect, but it has been successful over the last 23 years in many ways. They underestimate what an example Ireland has been for other parts of the world that are torn apart by division and ongoing conflict. And so when thousands of young people come to Belfast in 2023, they will be coming to Belfast with an expectation of experiencing and seeing for themselves what a successful peace process looks like. What an island that has found a way to move away from violence and intolerance and hatred to something very different, which is what in many ways Belfast represents now for people who don't understand the detail and the intricacies and the tension that is still in and part of Northern Ireland, but see it from afar as a peace process, 23 years old, still surviving, and a society that has been that has grown up on the back of that. I mean, 1.3 million young people in Ireland have been born since 1998. And their perspectives on identity and their perspectives on the future need to be very much central to how politicians like myself and others plan for that future. Because that is a perspective that is post a peace agreement, that is not necessarily influenced in the same way that it is for others, by the trauma of violence. And so what I would say to you is don't disappoint all of those people who I'm sure will come from places like Colombia, places like the Middle East, places like North Africa, that are coming wanting to be inspired by the Northern Ireland story of finding a way against all of the odds to build a peaceful, tolerant society. So I'm happy that the Irish government would play any part that we can in ensuring that that project is a success, Conor. And your three pillars, if you like, of listening honestly, informing people around values rather than identity, perhaps, and empowering people to actually act to try to generate momentum around that kind of positivity. I think that's a very solid basis, not only for young people to advocate in the future, but perhaps for governments as well. So don't underestimate how influential a relatively small place like Northern Ireland is in other parts of the world. We see that in Washington all the time. You know, the United States, the world's superpower, sees the Good Friday Belfast Agreement as one of their most successful foreign policy initiatives of the last 50 years. You know, that's how they see it. And that's why they see themselves as a guarantor of that process and intervene in the way that they do at different times. So if Northern Ireland as a story has that kind of influence in Washington, imagine the influence that it has in other parts of the world too. And that, I think, is a great privilege, but a great responsibility in the context of what we're all trying to do to make sure that we bed down that peace process and make sure that it's the basis for the kind of future that we're trying to generate.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you, Conor. We're going to take a next question now from Eileen Weir from the Shankill Women's Centre. Eileen.
Thanks for the invite. I work for Shankill Women's Centre currently, and my role is a coordinator of networks across North and West Belfast. I'm funded by Good Relations, which I have been involved for the last 40 years, give or take. And part of my role is to build those relationships between communities and to try and unite people. I think it was 18 years ago, there was a big emphasis of doing cross-border work, which it doesn't seem to be the same now. I was very lucky to be part of a programme who worked with TALA for 7 years, and those women we're still in touch with now and still have great relationships. We visit them. They come to Belfast. They come to join us. But sadly, that stopped because TALA wasn't a border town. So it's very restrictive of any funding that's there to build relationships across the island. I have been working and fighting and trying to campaign to bring younger people on board. It's something that this work needs to continue for a number of years to come. And we keep talking about, and we keep hearing about building apprenticeships for industry. I would like to see apprenticeships for community and bring people on board from the areas who are working very, very hard on the ground. It seems to be that women's voices don't be heard very often, and the number of documents that have been produced, in particular over this last year, of the work of women that have been getting done at grassroots level. And when I say grassroots level, it's not somebody sitting in an organisation at a grassroots location. It's about the women who are out there hands-on grassroots work. And that seems to be neglected. We have been working for the last 22, 23 years to implement the parts of the Good Friday Agreement that we agreed to. But 10 years before the Good Friday Agreement, the women's sector and the women's movement was working very, very hard to ensure that we have a better future, not just for ourselves as women, but for our families and for our young people, to make a better life for them. How can this work be supported in the future?
Well, first of all, can I thank you for the work that you're doing? Because it's very valuable. We have this very privileged role at the moment in the United Nations. We're on the UN Security Council for the next 2 years. And one of the roles that we have as one of those 15 countries on the Security Council, along with the UK, of course, who are a permanent member of the Security Council, is that we chair a committee on what's called Women, Peace and Security, which really is about trying to ensure that there is an involvement of female and woman leadership in peace processes, in conflict management, in post-conflict reconstruction, within communities, as well as physical reconstruction. And again, we often use the example of the peace process in Ireland post the Good Friday Agreement and during its negotiation, the role of really impactful women in that story and that journey. And in many ways, organizations like the Shankill Women's Centre, you know, do a lot of the tough work on the ground in terms of trying to reinforce the positive elements of the Good Friday Agreement, to improve community relations and so on. So we need to practice what we preach as a government. You know, we talk about this being vital internationally, and so nationally, and indeed on the island between the two jurisdictions. We will continue to support you from a funding perspective in a practical sense, which, you know, is an obvious starting point. We will be launching a new strategy on our reconciliation fund, which will involve significantly more money. Actually, we increased the funding last year for the rec fund. We're going to increase it again, and we'll be launching that strategy before the summer. And I hope you'll see a very real and strong commitment from the Irish government to help to fund and continue to support the work that you're doing. I think it's a really interesting example or analogy, I should say, that you talk about, you know, the prioritisation of apprenticeships within different economic sectors in terms of job creation and reskilling and so on. And that concept of an apprenticeship programme for community work and civil society, I think, is a very worthy concept, I have to say. I haven't heard it put that way before. But look, we're there to do what we can in terms of funding and support. And we'll, you know, we'll certainly continue to reach out to you, Eileen, if we can do more from a funding perspective than we're doing today, that would be helpful in terms of your centre.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you, Eileen. Our next question this morning comes from Ireland's Future and Patricia McBride. Patricia.
Good morning. Ireland's Future over the last 2 years or more has taken a number of steps to try and stimulate discussion, facilitate dialogue within the civil society space, and that includes hosting debates and discussions on issues like a vision for a new Ireland involving young people and people from minority communities across the island, looking at issues around Brexit and the Irish Protocol, and encouraging debate and discussion within the unionist community through a series of discussions and online debates. We've published a number of research documents and discussion documents, including a principled framework for change, shaping the constitutional future. And today we'll publish a document entitled Planning for a Strong Economy in a New Ireland. My question to you, Minister, is will the government consider establishing an all-island citizens' assembly, which would have a mandate to identify and propose areas of work, research and investment that can advance the shared island agenda?
Yeah, Thanks, Patricia, and thank you for the work that you're doing and Ireland's Future is doing in this space, because it's a contribution, I think, that's welcome. I mean, look, the first thing I'd say is that the Shared Island Dialogue series is about much of what you're talking about, which is to try to invite a conversation rather than force it, to encourage people to be part of that, and to ensure that it's as fully inclusive as possible. And I think, I hope certainly people's experience of that is positive in the context of what's happened so far in the Shared Island Initiative around the conversation on around young people's priorities, climate and environment, civil society today, and moving on to healthcare, education, economic development, and so on. So we are trying to do what you're talking about through a Shared Island Initiative. Of course, the government has an open mind on how to add to that in terms of engaging more perspectives and more people. And a citizens' assembly, an all-Ireland citizens' assembly, is one way, certainly, of doing that. I mean, what I would say, though, is that these dialogues and these processes are only as good as the people who participate in them. So, you know, if you set up an all-Ireland citizens' assembly and a lot of people don't participate or stay away from it for whatever reason, well, then you get a warped perspective and not a balanced one in the context of outcomes. So I think the real challenge here is, how do we find a structure that everybody would be willing to buy into and participate in to actually have the kind of conversations that are taking place in Ireland now? Some of them are awkward and difficult. I know that. We all have different perspectives in terms of where we would like the future of Ireland to be in 5 years' time, 10 years' time, 20 years' time, and further into the future. The real challenge is, how do we create a process that's inclusive, where everybody is genuinely listened to, where people's perspectives aren't dismissed by a majority of others or whatever. So I suppose the straight answer to your question is, the Irish government has an open mind in relation to the setting up of an all-Ireland citizens' assembly. But the really important question here is, how can we set up a structure that that all communities will be represented in, and a way of having that and holding that conversation that allows people to speak freely in a way that is understood and respected, even though a lot of those conversations, I think, may be difficult and strained. So the structure itself doesn't solve the problem. It's finding a way to create a space of trust and tolerance, if you like, that allows that conversation to take place in a way that hopefully might surprise people in terms of the kind of issues that we might be able to explore together, which may not be as offensive as some people seem to think it might be. And the other thing I think is really important is, we can't have a predetermined outcome. So, you know, this argument of, we need to set up a citizens' assembly to try to have an inclusive conversation around the reunification of Ireland. Like, if that's our starting point, it's very hard to get everybody into that conversation. So we cannot have a predetermined outcome. We've got to actually have a conversation that is genuinely open, that starts on the basis of trust and respect for different perspectives and different versions of history to date, and different ambitions for the future. And then let's see where that takes us in terms of a conversation, if that's the approach we're taking, if we want it to be fully inclusive. Otherwise, the conversations will be as they kind of are today for some people. People will advocate for their own perspective and look to try to create a majority around that perspective over time, under the, you know, the mechanisms of the Good Friday Agreement around the principle of consent and so on. So the real challenge here is, can we have something that is genuinely more inclusive than that, that doesn't have a predetermined outcome, and can we build trust in a conversation in that space? I think that's very challenging, particularly given the some of the issues we're trying to deal with at the moment that have become very polarized in terms of perspective and outlook. But I think we need to keep trying, because I actually think the basis of your question is extremely valid. We do have to talk about the future of this island and what it looks like and how we can guarantee a quality of life and a respect and a generosity for the future that allows everybody to at least be involved in that discussion.
Minister, thank you. Patricia, thank you. Our next question is from representing a group called We Make NI, which aims to make Northern Ireland work better. And asking the question today is Alison Grundle. Alison.
Hello, Minister. Thank you. During the Brexit negotiations, we saw from civic and business leaders in Northern Ireland a really positive can-do attitude to developing practical and workable solutions. Given the current political issues that we're having with the implementation of the protocol, what can the Irish government do to help build economic relationships, particularly with the United States, and put across the message that this whole island is a place where the US can do business? Thank you.
Yeah, well, first of all, I think that's a really good question. Yesterday, actually, I was on a video conference debate on that very issue, actually, in terms of relationships between the island of Ireland as a whole and the United and the US. It was hosted by Business and Finance magazine, and it was it was really a reminder to me just how connected the current Biden administration is to Ireland, to the well-being of this island as a whole, north and south, and how much they want to be involved in progress, positive progress, in terms of economic development, political stability, making sure that the Good Friday Agreement and its structures work as designed. So the first thing I'd say is we're pushing an open door here, and we perhaps need to be doing it together a bit more in terms of political leaders north and south, business leaders north and south, because I think you'd be surprised at the positivity of the reception that we would get if we do that. I mean, because a lot of the conversations I've had with political leaders in Washington has been around explaining the protocol, the disruptive impact of Brexit, and how we have to try to manage that on the island of Ireland, why preventing border infrastructure between north and south is so important, why we need to limit to the greatest extent possible checks in ports in Larne and Belfast in the context of goods coming from Great Britain into Northern Ireland, but at the same time, why that is important in terms of protecting Ireland's place in the EU single market for goods, which is, you know, the in many ways the foundation for economic prosperity in the Republic of Ireland, and indeed to a certain extent in Northern Ireland too. So I think there is a very receptive ear in Washington to understand how US investment in terms of economic impact, how that could be a very positive driver of reinforcing the point that actually the protocol's not all bad. You know, it's been the elements of the protocol that are very difficult, in particular for unionism, has been the focus of debate on the protocol since its implementation. And of course, some of the practical problems in terms of checks and bureaucracy and delays and so on that have frustrated people. But actually the other side of the protocol is this extraordinary economic opportunity for Northern Ireland, whereby it is the only place outside of the European Union that is still effectively de facto part of the EU single market for goods, and at the same time has unfettered access into the rest of the United Kingdom, into GB. The investment opportunities there for companies that want to manufacture product or to provide services into the British market, or indeed into the EU single market in the case of goods, is a very unique opportunity It's a very special arrangement in many ways that was specifically designed by the British government and the EU, obviously involving the Irish government as well, for Northern Ireland. It's not perfect. I know that. It needs pragmatic implementation, and it needs some flexibility, in my view, in terms of that implementation. But in essence, the protocol is about a solution designed to deal with the disruption of Brexit as best we can, to try to maintain stability as best we can in Northern Ireland. And, you know, some people have very different perspectives than me on this, but I think over time, the protocol, if we can make it work with pragmatism and flexibility where appropriate, can work actually to drive significant increased investment in Northern Ireland. And much of that will come from the US. And certainly I'd be very open to making that case jointly with political leaders from Northern Ireland in Washington and elsewhere across the US, where I think we'd get a very receptive welcome.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you, Alison. Another question now from the General Secretary of the Irish Congress of Trades Unions, Patricia King.
So the Irish Congress of Trade Unions is an all-Ireland organisation and has been engaged over many decades in building peace in Northern Ireland. And you know, I suppose we have gained a lot of knowledge that we have to share. And our own belief is that the sign of a mature society at ease with itself is the measure and depth of its social dialogue. So I suppose my question is, that is it envisaged that social dialogue across the island between trade unions, employer bodies, community and voluntary sector, etc., would assist in the development of this shared island project?
Well, that's an easy question for me to answer, and the answer is yes. Patricia, you know, you and I have had many debates in relation to Brexit-related issues, you know, you represent the trade union movement on the stakeholders group that meets every 6 weeks or so in terms of trying to navigate the, at times, stormy waters of the Brexit journey that's been going on now for 4.5 years. And your perspectives in those conversations have very much been representative not just of your members south of the border, but also north of the border too, in terms of the trade union movement there. So whether it's a debate around a future Bill of Rights, for example, in terms of social rights and workers' rights and so on, and how that gets managed, or indeed whether it's the pragmatism that's needed to ensure that the solutions that have been agreed to try to bed down the protocol to try to resolve the disruptive impact as best we can of Brexit. For me, the conversations need to involve workers who are very much impacted directly by these issues in terms of their day-to-day lives. And so the trade union movement and broader civil society, I think, have to be part of those discussions. And I think we have a very good example, if you like, and a template in the context of how we discussed and debated pretty vigorously at times how we would manage the Brexit process from an Irish perspective. And I think, you know, that kind of approach of continuous dialogue and discussion and interaction is where we need to be in some of these other questions as well, where I think the trade union movement can make a very both relevant and helpful contribution to gaining acceptance. Because, you know, within the trade union movement, you know, in many ways, the issues you focus on are not necessarily coloured by some of the other political questions and identity-based perspectives. They are focused on issues around workers' rights, societal well-being, many of the other issues that the trade union movement campaign on the back of. So yes is the straight answer. We'd be very much open to trying to put a structure in place that can facilitate that. And if we could do that north and south, I think that would be even better again.
Minister, thank you. Thank you, Patricia, as well. Keep your questions coming. They're terrific, and it's great to have your participation today. Another question now from Avila Kilmurray from Social Change Initiative. Avila.
Thank you, Minister, for your interest and your engagement. Among other things, I was involved with the Women's Coalition during the Good Friday negotiations. And one of the things that really enthused us was the concept of a charter of rights across the island of Ireland. Nothing much has moved around that. And I was wondering if you would see that as part of the Shared Island Initiative, because we used to bring over Albie Sachs to talk about the experience in South Africa and how the discussion around the Charter of Rights actually was participative and included everybody. And the possibility is, I think, that if we could look at discussing rights in its broadest sense, that could be a way of reaching out to people, both north and south, but also to people in new communities, incoming communities, and minority groups. So it would be great if the Shared Island Initiative could take that on board.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's certainly a good topic there for maybe a focused dialogue around the role of, you know, a rights-based approach to certain issues. So we're having that debate down here, for example, on housing. You know, how do you enshrine a right to housing in a way that is practical and actually impacts on people's lives for the better? And you know, obviously, many other rights issues as well, around the right to clean water, for example. You know, is a private member's motion coming through the, you know, our parliamentary system this week from the Green Party. Likewise, rights around education and so on. So, you know, I know, having been in Belfast for many, many hours, I was there, you know, at one point almost twice a week, every week for nearly a year, that a rights-based approach towards policy development in Northern Ireland was the source of a lot of discussion and debate and disagreement and so on, as we tried to put together the New Decade, New Approach agreement. But there is, you know, there is increased discussion now around a Bill of Rights, which isn't that dissimilar, I think, to a Charter of Rights, which is what you're talking about. You know, and I do think progressing that debate is a positive thing. Some elements of that debate, some people find threatening, and we have to find a way of dealing with that. But, you know, I think the Good Friday Agreement did envisage moving into this space, certainly. And there has been talk for a very long time about a Bill of Rights in Northern Ireland being agreed by an executive and the Assembly. And, you know, it's obviously not for me to be telling political leaders in Northern Ireland what they need to do. That's a matter for them. But certainly that has been a source of discussion. And the more of a parallel approach that we can create north and south on the rights issue, I think the more helpful perhaps that would be.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you, Avila. Another question now, this time from Jarlath Kearney. Jarlath.
Thank you, Minister. One of my roles is as an Equality Commissioner in Northern Ireland. And as part of that, I also sit on the working group between the Human Rights Commission in the North, the Irish Human Rights and Equality Commission, and ourselves in the Equality Commission, on the implementation of the Article 2 protocol issues around non-diminution of equality and human rights. I was struck by a comment you made earlier, Minister, about the fact that we cannot avoid complexity. And I think that that's absolutely critical to the debate and the realities as we go forward. We face a couple of certain facts, one of which is that today the realpolitik in 2021 is that we have two states on the island. The other is that there is an imperative and a logic to create much greater one system approaches on the island. And what I wonder is this, Minister, to what extent can we encourage a two states, one system approach unless we also encourage much greater bilateral Ireland-UK relationships being rebuilt, albeit in the context of a very significant impact on trust recently, and to what extent civil society in Ireland can assist the diplomatic space within which that can take place?
That's not an easy question to answer, but it's a very relevant one. So just a number of issues there. I mean, first of all, the commitment around a non-diminution of rights in the context of the protocol and the withdrawal agreement is a really important aspect of the outcome of the Brexit negotiations in terms of providing reassurance to many people in Northern Ireland in that space. It's not actually something that's got a lot of political attention since the 1st of January when the protocol effectively took effect, because we've been discussing and debating other issues around the level of checks, whether they be SBS checks, you know, customs declarations and all the other things in the ports of Belfast and Larne and so on. But I think as time passes, we do need to delve into this detail. That is why we have a specialised committee specifically set up to do that as part of the protocol structures. That's why that leads into a joint committee, which has senior political leaders from the British government and from the European Commission. So we need to make sure that within those debates, particularly in the specialised committee, and there's one this week, these issues are addressed and the detail of them are addressed. I mean, look, we have tried, and we've we've touched on some of these issues already in relation to health insurance across the EU, which was an issue around trying to protect people's rights as EU citizens, albeit living outside of the EU in Northern Ireland. We as an Irish government have tried to protect that by protecting the Erasmus programme for young students in Northern Ireland who want to continue to participate in the Erasmus programme and study in other parts of Europe. They can do that now through Irish universities. But there are many other areas around ensuring that there isn't a diminution of people's rights because of Brexit. But it is a complex area, and it's an area where I think we need to have more debate, and we need to be listening to civil society, who I think probably need to be at the centre of this debate, because in many ways people's rights in Northern Ireland have been very effectively advocated for through civil society for the last 23 years since the peace process. And that's where much of the real face-to-face work happens in this space. In terms of the one system, two states, look, I mean, the thrust and the whole sort of ambition of the Good Friday Agreement was that there would be more and more cooperation north-south, but that also that cooperation could be reinforced east-west as well. And there are structures to do that, whether it's north-south ministerial meetings, whether it's the east-west structures of the Good Friday Agreement. And to be perfectly honest with you, you know, those structures are not working as they need to and should be. And governments have a responsibility to address that. And, you know, the distractions of and the tensions around trying to manage Brexit and its fallout and the protocol and its fallout have been unwelcome, but that's the reality we live in. I mean, my personal relationships with ministers in the British government is pretty good. You know, with the Secretary of State in Northern Ireland, very good relationship with Michael Gove, very good relationship. And getting to know David Frost, we haven't had a one-to-one meeting yet, but I'm sure we will. But back to the point of your question, which is the more we can do together, I think the more sense that makes. But of course, we have to make that case and win that argument. And we've been trying to do that for the last 12 months in the context of a more agreed approach, north and south, towards managing the pandemic. Sometimes that's worked out well. in terms of us announcing restrictions at the same time in very similar areas. Sometimes it hasn't worked so well, like, for example, with international travel, where we have a different approach. You know, having said that, just to reassure people, we do talk all the time around managing COVID and how we can prevent either north or south impacting on each other in a negative way, depending on what stages we're at around vaccine rollout or prevalence of the virus or whatever. I think the relationship between the British and Irish governments is central to this, and of course the relationship and trust between political leaders in Dublin and London and political leaders in Northern Ireland, who ultimately have the responsibility for the well-being of people in Northern Ireland, is also very important and has been, let's be honest, damaged over the last number of months around the issues that we've referred to. We will continue to focus on rebuilding and improving those relationships and putting structure around that. The Prime Minister and the Taoiseach have already spoken about that, what kind of structure we may look to put in place to reinforce the relationship between Dublin and London. And I think we need to probably increase the dialogue north-south as well in the context of some of these issues, particularly around the protocol, so that we can debunk some of the myths and really listen to each other in terms of what the problems are in terms of implementation and how we can resolve them together.
Minister, thank you so much. Jarla, thank you for your question. I think we've just time for one more, and it's to do with the arts, because arts, like sports, are great ways of breaking down barriers and increasing just fun and entertainment and education among people. So Frieda Manweiler from the Smashing Times has a question. Frieda.
Hello. First of all, I just want to thank everybody involved in the Shared Ireland Dialogue Series, and we're delighted to be involved. Smashing Times is a professional organisation using the arts to promote equality, human rights and diversity. And there is a move across Europe for artists to call on governments to put the arts at the centre of any process to rebuild societies after the pandemic. So we would love to know what support there will be for putting the arts centre stage, because they are a brilliant way to create a shared community space. And particularly when the arts are used to promote values of equality, equity, human rights and diversity. And we've also found that when we engage in the arts at a local level and bring in a global perspective, it really opens up the work. So again, we'd be very interested in support for the idea of having a global perspective at a local level and using the arts to engage communities in a shared space.
Yeah, Frieda, I mean, first of all, the last year has been a really difficult year for the arts. So when you can't perform in front of people and make that connection, it's a difficult time to be a performing artist. I know people can do it on social media platforms and host virtual concerts and all the rest of it, but that's a very different thing to actually interacting with an audience and inspiring them, changing perspectives through the visual and performing arts and so on. I mean, what you say reminds me of traveling to Belfast. It was in 2016 when we were trying as a government then to manage the 2016 commemorations in a way that was as inclusive and responsible as we could. And I remember a performance in a theatre in Belfast around that theme of 2016. And it was a really powerful performance, and lots of people were there, lots of political leaders and so on. And it was a real example to me of how you can do things sometimes through the arts that you just can't do as a politician in a sort of a in political language. So I do think that whether it's dealing with legacy, whether it's reconciliation, whether it's community development, whether it's trying to build a more tolerant and generous and inclusive debate, I think the role of artists and the way they think and the perspective that they can get across in a different language, if you like, is something that we should try to harness. And I talk about that in terms of, you know, future debates and discussions. In terms of post-pandemic, getting an arts community back up and running and back on their feet again, given the financial challenges, let's face it, as well as performance challenges they've had for the last 12 months, is a challenge in its own right. I mean, we're assigning quite a significant amount of money. You would have seen Minister Catherine Martin announce a number of different and quite significant funding initiatives for the arts community, and that will continue as we move to, I hope, a recovery phase post-pandemic, when every adult on this island that wants a vaccine will be able to get one, hopefully by late summer, and we'll be in a very different space in terms of how we're managing the risk linked to COVID. And at that point, you know, I think we will see north and south many people yearning for that connection that can be created through artistic performance and the expression of that. So look, from my government's perspective, that will be part of what we're doing in terms of recovery and getting society back up on its feet, not just an economy, after this sort of extraordinary period of restriction and tension and tragedy that we've seen over the last 12 months.
Minister, thank you so much indeed. And Frieda, thank you for your question. And the Minister is going to leave us now. Thank you for sharing your morning with us here at Dublin Castle.